Today, I'm talking with Travis Willingham about his new character, Ford, voice acting, and the freedom that comes with creating your very own character.
I struggled a lot more than most of the rest of the cast. I think other people had already, like, as the first campaign was drawing to a close, already had like a little idea bubbling in the back of their head about who their next character was going to be, and I was not doing that. I was not cheating on Grog until it was done. And then when it was finally done, I realized how I was just completely directionless. I thought maybe paladin, I thought maybe fighter. I knew I still needed something melee-based, because that's just how I tend to think in a tactical situation. But I knew that having no spells, and having gone 5 years in playing D&D and never casting a true spell, that wasn't going to work. So Laura actually wanted to play a cleric first, and as she described it and got very excited, I was like, ooh, I think I want to do that. And she was like, fine, you can be a cleric. I think I'm going to make a warlock. And as she started to describe what the warlock could do, I was like, I want to do that. I think I want to be a warlock. And she was like, fine. I just kept snagging what she would take. And then in the Xanathars, they introduced the Hexblade. And I was like, oh no, sentient weapons. It started a little spark of imagination. So I decided to go with the new Hexblade and explore it at least, so that I would have some melee stuff as well as some spells. Flying back from Australia, when you're locked in a solid metal tube for 16 hours with a blank sheet of paper on a computer, you write a sentence and it turns into a paragraph, and then it turns into several pages of backstory, and that's where Ford came from. There's a tremendous amount of pressure. It is not the same as when we were just playing in our living room and nobody was watching and there were no social media comments, immediately after the game was over. You're far freer to screw up or do something incorrectly or just make a dud of a character. Like, there's, you're never going to hear about it, or you might from your friends, but who cares? With the audience that Critical Role has, it's impossible not to go like, oh God, I hope I make something that people like, or that they are inspired by, or, I mean, even if they hate it voraciously, at least that's like, some sort of interaction that you want to build. So you're just kind of worried about making like a dud, like a middle of the road, nothing that doesn't really have anything attached to it. And I found myself there in our session zero, which was our, I guess, sort of our experimenting phase, where we, first got to put the skin on of the character. And I decided that because Grog was such a moron, that I was going to have a higher intelligence and that I would be able to speak with a regular vocabulary and read and all those wonderful things. And I had decided just to use my own voice. And about a half hour into it, I hated it. Like, I hated it. And I didn't know what I was going to do. And it wasn't until earlier in that week, I was doing a video game session, and the character had like a deeper southern drawl, and by the time the 2 hours was over with, I was like, well, shit, I wonder if I could, is it cool to have a southern accent, like a Texan accent in D&D, in a fantasy world? So I asked Matt, and he was like, why not? And I'm like, yeah, why not? So that's where it came from. That first session was so crazy, because I know we were all so confident in the first campaign, and watching, in my opinion, everybody but Laura, just like meekly peek out from behind the curtains of their character, and like barely using their accent and barely taking any chances and stuff like that. I think everybody kind of followed Laura's example out into the sunshine of the second campaign, because otherwise we would have been, I think, just as shy as we were the first couple of minutes for quite a while.
Yeah, Liam's accent has certainly become increasingly German with every episode.
Yeah, like Liam went from like subtly German, which he thought was going to come across, to like, oh, he's not doing an accent. He was like, no, I'm doing a German accent. And like, oh, there's a little German. He's like, fine, I am full German. This is like the whole thing. And we love Taliesin, because the Irish dial just goes up and down and up and down and up and down. So, people like Taliesin, he was like, this is a chance for me to perfect my Irish accent. We're like, or work on it. So it's like, it's one of those things where as a voiceover artist, it's nice to try on an accent that maybe you haven't had a lot of experience with. I think one of the hidden benefits of voice acting is sort of the level of anonymity that we enjoy. Like, we work on a lot of like a lot of you were used to a lot of like video games and animation and I mean there are certainly fans and there are certainly the people that know that we are who we are, but it's not, you know, we're not in the breakfast aisle getting noticed, or well, I guess it happens sometimes now because of the show, but you know, you can show up in pajamas and it doesn't matter how old you are, how young you are, it doesn't matter what you look like or tall, skinny, you know, pretty, ugly, any of those things. It's just about what you can do with your voice. And one of the things I loved about theater so much in college was that it was, you know, the theater of the imagination, the fourth wall. Even though there's an audience out there, you had a whole scenario that was in your mind, and it you were agreeing to play in that space with the other actors on the stage. And in voiceover, it's the same thing. You don't have a set. You don't have usually other actors to act off of. There's no action that's happening. It's all in your head. You might be running in place or punching the air, but it's all just what you come up with yourself. And there's something that is very like play in the backyard, play in the sandbox about that, like when you were a kid, you know, your imagination just kind of took you wherever you want to. And that's what I love about D&D, is that everybody's agreeing to play in the same space. And even for the people that are watching it, what we have in our mind might not be the exact same thing that they see as they're watching the show. And that's why we enjoy the art so much, because you see what everyone's movie was in their head afterwards. And that's just incredible to witness. It's super freeing to know that the bullshit that you're coming up with in the moment is the truth, you know, whether people like it or not. It's just what you came up with. And there are moments where we feel the pressure, whether it was like the character creation or we want to know how a certain interaction went over, but we know immediately what the reaction is. And sometimes we take that into account because we're totally imperfect people that are bound to make mistakes. But most of the time it's just our game. Like, we're gonna do whatever we wanna do. We're gonna try and make each other laugh like we would if we were at our house. Most shit that Sam does cracks me up. And it's just, it's been really great to acknowledge amongst ourselves that we were never gonna let anything that the show does change our dynamic, our game, our friendship. And as long as, you know, that remains the same, then we think that, you know, the show will remain what it is. And that's been incredible. I think if every week had a live audience, it might be a lot different, because you would really see what, you know, the impact is. And when those live shows happen, it's incredible. But we like that it's Thursday, it's quiet, it's behind closed doors, we've got our drinks, we've got our friends, we're making asses of ourselves, and people like to watch that.
Thank you, Travis, for being on D&D Beyond, and be sure not to miss our Critical Role recaps. They appear on D&D Beyond every Friday about the previous night's episode. I'm Todd Kenrick. Thank you for watching.